Okay, so the next part we're going to work with is the actual engine bay itself, if you like, which also doubles up as the wheel wells. Now, the first thing you're going to have to do, if you want this to be really spot on, is down in here, how well you can actually see, if I just bring you in a bit, but you've actually got a couple of pin marks. You've got one right here, one to the other side of it. They've got to come out really. The one at this end isn't really noticeable because it covers, but it's on the edge if you like, so you can remove that one. And then the one at this end, I wouldn't worry about it at all. The way I get around it, I've got a little square file here. Very, very lightly, we're just trying to bring that one down. So what we're going to do, it's very lightly, just sand that. And say, just to bring it into, just to plane it down. You could fill, you know, obviously, but sometimes it's easier when there's just a literally, you're just talking millimeters of a difference, just to pop along and sand it out. So there's one gone. Be a little bit more aggressive on that one. That's that one gone. It's quite a deep one. Is that one going? And just the one on this side. So make quite a rough area of them, just like that. And then you can come along with various sanding sticks and other bits and pieces and just sand them in to make them a little bit nicer. I'll continue with that in a moment. And then basically all you're going to do, you're going to put both these ends parts in, which are going to make up your main gear wheel well. So you're going to have one go on the front like that. So we just put a drop of glue just at each end. Just going to hold that and the capillary will work its way around. And then you've got one for the front end as well, which is up near those parts we were just doing. They'll only go on one way because there's a slight difference in gap with the width of them, the way they are apart. So we just do that side as well. Just like that. And then what you've got are these little guys here, which I forget their part names off the top of my head. I think it's 4 and 7, and they go in. They've got little slightly different holes, but they're just going to go in just in here. So we just put some glue in right in there. And it's handy to do this with some tweezers. It just makes them easier to get in. And the way to remember is that the one with just the normal square hole goes on the bottom. Just like that. The one with a slight taper on it, on the bottom hinge, goes to the top. But there we go. They go in like that. And then we've just got the two others. Just gonna go one on this side, which can be a bit tricky. That's it, and the last one in the bottom like that. And then we've got these bands which run around the top part. So you've just got the hole there, so what I do is just put a drop of glue in the area already. And these bands go over. So we've got one running over that side. It's going to fit in there. And same again for the other side. Now there is another one that goes across the middle. But the thing is, you need that one to be out of the way a moment because you need it for the actual closing of the actual parts. So then what happens is you've got the rest of the air intake, if you like, leading to the actual engine itself. So that's quite straightforward. That's going to sit on. Okay, and we're going to run some thin glue on the outside like that, just running it down. Let that dry for a moment, or to go hard a bit, and then you should come back with something like this. This one's done already. Okay, so then what we've actually done is run thin glue, and we'll run a little bit more just down the center and then you should, if you've got a brush on it, be able to get both directions, and it'll weld up those joins in there, and then we can spray this entire section white as they are on the real thing for the actual air intake and everything, so when it's fitted in we can then mask it over, close the doors on it, something like that, to keep it all safe. But that's that area done. Now in the same time we can do is paint this area, which is the front of the engine, if you like, is going to show through, which is basically, it's got a little locator tab on here, and that is going to fit there, so when you look in, so to speak, you can see the engine, although you're going to have to crane your neck a bit to be able to see, because there is a slight slope coming up from the front part of the intake, which we'll take care of. But that's best to paint that now silver, or whichever type of silver you're going to paint it for the compressor blades, and then fit it after you've actually sprayed it white. Okay, so one of the big things we need to do with the F-16, very noticeable because of the big air intake, is to lose that seam in the middle. Now, it's not a bad join between the two, but it's worth getting this part done right now, and you can get the glue sort of working on it. The way I do it, I just hold it together, generous amounts of extra thin down there, both sides. And say, don't worry about it, just really slap it on and get it in there for stage one. Okay, hold them together, make sure there's no massive big joins or anything else like that you can see in there. It should be quite a nice fit anyway. Okay, then once we've got that going, like I've done here, more extra thin on your brush, nice big pull, and literally pour it or run it down the seams. Now they're not big enough to really warrant huge amounts of filling jobs like we've done on the older and other kits we've been working on, but certainly it's worth getting down there. Now if you have got a clean oldish brush, you don't mind getting gluey. I've got one just here, so I've got my pot of glue literally in there, nice generous amount, and we're just going to paint it, those seams all in there, literally all the way around there, just trying to weld them up nicely for the moment. And take care. Now I've got a little bit of black on there, which is quite handy because it's showing, you can see it pooling in there. So what we're going to do, we're going to let that dry off, see what it looks like then, and then we can go through the other steps we can do to take care of it, i.e. we bung up the end and we do the paint swilling and all the rest of it, once we get the white paint out. But we need that to dry off totally before we come back and have a look. You could use a Mr. Surfacer and brush that down there, usual things, but obviously getting in there afterwards to clean up is going to be a bit of a problem, but I have a plan for that, as I always do with these things, and I'll show you in a minute. Okay, so the intakes have been drying. So what I've actually done is we've got a little bit of our thinned, which is just cellulose thinners and normal putty, thinned down, and I've brushed it in and it's dried. Now, usual thing, it's cracked up a little bit, all the rest of it, but it's taking care of the seam. So then we're gonna come in with some cellulose thinners on a cotton bud. Okay, and what we're gonna do is give it a bit of a rub down in that intake. Now we'll start at the rear, and just keep it moving all the time. It's important to keep it moving because you're using cellulose thinners, it's actually melting the plastic. So you don't want to drag anything. You want to keep your bud nice and wet and doing its work. Okay, so we go back in again, and you're basically just rubbing it all out and rubbing down until you've got no green putty left, apart from perhaps a little bit going on in that groove which we're trying to fill. Okay, so then we'll just switch to the front. And we're just going to keep going like this until we've got almost all the putty out. So you want to keep it going in there and scraping out. Now what's happening is also, by using cellulose thinners, as I've been experimenting with this last few weeks, you're actually, because you're melting the plastic together, you will make a totally seamless finish. A slight drawback is when this stuff dries, it dries quite rough, and sometimes you get, if you've over rubbed it in certain areas and in certain things, you end up with it scratched and a bit of a problem. So to counter that, once you've had a good wipe round, it's always handy, last time, plenty of thinners on it, and just give it a wipe round literally everywhere in there, and it will self-level itself as well, okay, with the thinners. Right, if we bring you in nice and close, you might be able to see what we've got going on here. So hopefully you can see, but you don't actually get a seam line as such in there, because it's one, filled, two, it's melted it. So it's all gone in one. Now this dries quite well, but then what I do is come along here, we just try and dry this off. Because it's thinners, it dries very, very quickly. Get yourself some clamps, clamp it on, and then what we'll do is, going this way, we're going to dip this. I've got a pool here of some just some normal Johnson's clear, like this, or you can use any type of lacquer you want. And there we go, it's in there. So we're just going to let that swim. Okay, and then we're going to pull it out, and then just over here, we've got a paper towel. All right, and then we're just going to stack it on its tail in there to dry off like that. Now I've got one here which had a bath about 3 or 4 minutes ago for the other one, so we're just going to double dip it again, a bit like we do with canopies, because this one didn't get a massive job like that first one did. So there we go, that's giving it a dip, and then same again, we stick it on its tail and out it goes to the back end as well. And we can let those dry naturally now, give them about an hour to totally dry off, pour your future back in so you're not wasting it, and hopefully you've made yourself there a very, very nice seamless intake. Okay, so these parts have now been drying overnight, as you say, where we did that welding effect to up there. Very happy with it. Don't know how well you'll be able to see in here, but we'll try and see the best. But as you can see, we've got no seams really to speak of in there at all. They've totally all gone. So we don't have to worry about them anymore, and obviously you can't even see any where the filler was because it has melted it completely over, just like that. So the big thing we want to do is take care of is now got to spray it. So we got in here quite a thick white mix, as you can probably hear from the old compressor. We need a bit of air. So what you're going to do is just going to put in, at the moment, because we've dipped it, we've given it a sort of a shiny finish in there, but it's not going to be perfect. So what we're going to do is just very lightly for the moment, give this one coat of about 90% paint to 10% thinners, quite a thick mix of Tamiya flat white. Air pressure is going to be at quite a high, about 30 psi, and all we're going to do is lightly blow in the intakes. Because all we're trying to do is give this a nice effect. If you overdo this and flood it, you're going to end up with big runs going on in there. And what we're trying to get is quite a nice seam going in there, sort of seamless, nice and white. And then what we can do, once it's got some white paint in there, we can come along then and physically dip them in like we do and flood the area. So if you can have a look just down in there, as you can see, there's no seam at all. The seam lines have totally gone now. And that's just by one. By the time we've dipped it and got in there, we'll have nothing whatsoever. So we're going to do the same to this part as well. Same thing, and also at the same time, we're going to spray all this white everywhere. So really, this entire object's going to be white, because obviously the undercarriage wells. And at the same time, what we want to do is spray this area down in here, which is going to be the inside. Then when this all comes together, we can mask all that up for when it has its ghost grey. Obviously, if you're doing the Thunderbirds one or something else like that, it's all going to be white anyway, so that's not so much of a problem. But for this one, we need it all to be white. Okay, so if you've still got a groove running down the inside and various bits and pieces like that, another way you can do it, if you didn't want to do it that way, is what I call the actual sort of tip and swirl. Literally, take your paint, your gloss or your flat or whatever you're going to use. Okay, bit of blue tack just in the end there, stop it obviously pouring out the end, and then all we do is literally tip it in. Quite a generous amount, because you're going to need it to swill absolutely everywhere. And all we're going to do then, obviously I have to do it towards me because I need to see what's going on, we tip it almost out to the edge. Okay, and then roll it right up to the mouth. Okay, and make sure it's absolutely covering everywhere inside there. We're just going to run it towards the end again, almost there, and then we're just going to roll it. So you literally, you've just coated the entire inside just like that, and once you're done, just tip out all the rest of it completely out, and just let it all come out the end. All right, and then literally pull your backing off and let it stand, because you want it all to flow to the back, because you will get a little, perhaps a little ridge line like it. Now, you don't want your paint to be exactly too thick. You don't want it to be like lumpy and sort of, because otherwise you're going to get huge runs. So you're going to need to thin it a little bit. This has been thinned because it's come back into, from the airbrush back into there. So it has got a little bit of thinner on it, but that'll do. But what that helps is basically just get in those grooves and pull up all those grooves. As I say, it's best to leave it on its edge so it all drains towards the back, because otherwise if you lay it down flat, you might pull at the bottom and end up getting lines and that. But once you've done it, you do that. Leave it like it, let it all drain through and everything else, give it about an hour, come back, do it again, and do it as many times as you need it, and you can let it build up, and that'll fill in those grooves at the edges. Because we've taken care of it, obviously doing it with a bit of cellulose thinners and melted the plastic and done it that way, it's only going to need perhaps one or two. If you've got real big grooves on there, you're going to need a little bit more to help it go through. Then as soon as you've done that, we can do it again, pop it into some future, either do it with a brush or just by dip it in, and that'll give you that nice heavy duty. They look very plasticky when you look inside air intakes anyway, but especially if you're going to do something like a Thunderbird's F-16, that is very white in there, you know, it's extremely clean. Other aircraft, you get that sort of, it goes to like a grey effect, sort of a mottly colour in there, because obviously with the dirt build up and the crews perhaps crawling down there to check the compressor blades and various bits and pieces, they do get quite dirty and scrape marks in there. Okay, so there we go. We've got the actual the trunkings, if you like, for the air intakes done. And as you can see there, seamless, totally seamless. One thing I forgot to mention, if you do get a situation where you know, it starts to crack almost, it looks like it's cracked when you've dipped it, what that is basically your paint is a little bit too thin, and the thinners are melting through the previous coat, if you like, and that's what it's doing. And that way it does tend to pull apart. If it does, don't panic about it. Literally don't start thinking, oh, it's all gone wrong. Just give it another spray coat, a couple of spray coats, and then dip it in future. Now, these have been dipped in future again, literally just had a pot of it like this, straight in, straight out, stand them on their ends just like that and let them dry off. Also, it's another good opportunity, we can look at the differences between the actual intakes themselves. So as you can see there, one is a lot wider and the other one is a bit deeper, and that's the different types. So obviously this one on the top here, is what we call a block 32. Anything with a 2 on the end, like a 52 or something like that, will have this slightly deeper mouth, whereas any of the other ones, the block 50s, have the wider mouth, and it's just a little difference in there. There's various references you can look on there, but that's a nice shot there showing you the difference with the two. At the same time also, we've done here, we did exactly the same thing, if you can see down in there as well. We took out that seam just the same way, and I've literally just popped on the end, it's a push fit straight on the end there for the actual fan blades themselves. There again, when you look at the two, they have a slightly different, one of them's got more blades and than the other one. Obviously the block 52s have slightly different fan blades at the back. So there you go. But there we go, we sprayed those white as well. On the top, obviously this one here, because it's white, it shows it through a bit stronger, but the other one is sprayed white. And then what would actually happen later on, we'll be marrying up the two parts, so literally they fit together like that and make you a nice big trunking, so you can see down in there. Now that join isn't very noticeable from the inside, so we're not going to worry about taking care of that actually now, because when it is fitted to the actual model, you can't see it. But that's really, in all honesty, the hardest part of this entire kit is this intake and getting it right. Now there is aftermarket ones available at the moment that are just starting to come down the line now for making seamless intakes and putting them on. Is it worth doing it? Not sure. As I say, you spend a little bit of time, you can save yourself really just about sort of £15 doing that, versus, you know, you might want to go with a seamless one, and that way it's just a drop-in replacement like this, literally will just stick on, so you're still going to have that seam there. So if it's worth it, not too sure. So basically what's going to happen coming up in a moment, we're going to get the cockpit. Okay, and what we're going to do, we're going to take the seat and the bits and pieces all out of it like that, and then the tub is going to fit very nicely down into here, and will sit like that, and then this engine part will then mount just like that. Okay, so the next thing we can do is start getting these bits together. First thing to go in is the cockpit. So you've got three little holes here, so I'm assuming Tammy are going to be doing the two-seat version one day. Basically, the back hole on your seat here goes into this one. Top one goes into the front one. And it'll click when it's in, because it does need to sit in there properly and takes a bit of a wiggle. Okay, next thing is up where the engine and the wheel wells go. They mount into these four holes here, just like so. Okay, now fan to the rear. You're only actually going one way, and we sit this in. Now, it's quite important. You want to make sure that this is pushed right in properly. It needs to be in there and pushed right down. If it's not, what happens is when the front part of this air intake comes into it, it doesn't line up very well. And that's the secret, is to make sure this is down. If it clicks in, you know you're there because it's pushing right down hard. And then you should get hardly any little lines between the two. Up there, it should sit right down, very nice, very flush. Okay, so now we can get on some other bits and pieces on here. So we need to open up a few holes. You've got a very small one just here, which is a 0.5, but you can go a little bit bigger. And then on the other side, just like so. So there's those two behind the cockpit need opening up. Also, you need to open up one on the side of the fuselage at the top side here. So just open that one up as well. Sure you're all clean. That's a nice clean hole. There's that one. So we've opened up those, as well as at the back here, we've got for the tailplanes. You need to use these little rubber grommets, which come on a sprue, which look like that. Little rubbery plastic things. So we need two of those. Now it's always better to fit these before it's in, because there is a slight lip. So all you have is these parts here. We bring you in a little bit. There we go, we've got these parts here, and they're going to fit on to it just like that. This is the C8 parts, which then they'll push down into here, and you'll know when it's in right, because it actually push in and click in a little bit. So we just get some glue to hold those in properly. Same on the other side. That's those in. They do angle slightly down as well, so don't worry about that bit. Okay, so we can leave that going. Now the best thing you can do to make sure you get a nice tight fit on the front is to stick a couple of clamps. If you've got some spring-loaded, these are Tamiya clamps, or anybody's will do, and it will just hold that into position just like that. So if we leave that off to one side, we'll just hold it. Perhaps if you're using super glue, it won't take too long. Whilst those bits are doing, we can do the top of the fuselage front here for the top of the cockpit section. Also, you've got the gun to go in. Now, when you're removing it from the sprue, don't sand too much, because this, if you get it right, is literally a perfect drop-in fit, just like that. Then you come along with your extra thin and just touch and flow, and it will literally run around everywhere it needs to do and just weld that up to a very, very nice join, just like so. If you come in from the inside, just a touch, and it'll just help it all flow round everywhere and fill it up, and that's all you have to do, because it is that nice a join there. Same on the other side. You've got this little panel here. It's a little bit more tricky. As I say, don't over sand it, but it's going to go in just in here, which is number B2, and if you get it right, you won't get a gap at the bottom. If you don't, like there, it hasn't gone quite in correctly. We just need to get the back end of it in first, push that in with your nail, and the top then bends in just like that, and in it goes. And then it's easier to do it from the inside, that one. Just drop a glue and let the capillary action will go inside and push out, if you like. So I've done the same for the other one, and they're both done like that. So that's both the gun vents done and sorted out. Okay, so as you got that bit drying, the next thing we can actually do is get the two halves married up. Now, the reason it comes to this one, eventually, or we're hoping, Tammy's going to release the B&D version, which is the two-seat, which obviously then will just be a new plug-in part for the front. So in the meantime, you've got the seam down here. Now, this is what I was saying about earlier, about when you're removing this, not to sand too much off. And you may notice that you've got two little tabs that stick out just the tiniest little bit. Don't sand them off, because they actually do marry in with these here. So what we're going to do is get it in there and then push it down nice and hard, and make sure when you flip over you've got it in properly at this point, because what you're going to do, if you don't play with it too much, it's actually a very nice fit. and goes in there very nice. So if you stick your finger over the plug hole down there like that, flip it over and you push down, obviously not across the line but in front of it, and then just push each corner and then run your finger and make sure you haven't got any huge steps, you should be okay. And then you can come along with your Tamiya Extra Thin is a perfect example for this job, and just give it a bit of a run down there. Don't over flood it because otherwise you end up filling up panel lines, but you just want to put it in there and hold it literally just like this. And by holding it, you'll hold it and it will push slightly in those other ones. I've done this one already. I'll keep holding this one for a minute. I've done this one already, and when you run your finger over it, it's nice and smooth and you can't feel a step. If you do feel a little step, don't worry too much about it, because it's going to be a panel line anyway. So in some ways you can just pop back. If you are using the extra thin like I've used here, what you'll find is after an hour you can slightly manipulate it. It's not going to go rock hard like if you're going to use a super glue. So once you're in there, feel it. If you have got a bit of a step, just get your fingers each side of it and just push it in a bit harder, and you might find that you'll correct the problem without too much of a problem. So once you've got those parts done, you can literally marry the two up by popping these two in, and there again you should find it's actually a very nice fit. The only trouble you're going to have is on these side bits, so band them together, which I'll show you in a second. Okay, so the next part we can get on with now is getting the two halves together. Quite an important thing, so obviously we want to make this as minimal fuss, if you like, as possible to get these together. Okay, so what we're going to do, literally straightforward, one on top of the other. Your only problem area is going to be this one down here, but just take your time with it and it'll all be okay, because it does all push together. As I say, it's a fantastic kit. It really goes together nicely. If you have put your control sticks and that in there, word of advice, just be careful how you handle it around the cockpit, because they stick up, they do tend to get easily pulled off, snapped off. So just be a bit careful with that, because I have done that in the past. So what we're going to do, start with the front, glue the front, using Tamiya Extra Thin as normal. So we're just going to let that just get a bite. When we're on there for a bite, your next area to get is obviously this seam just down here, because if that's flat, it pushes that entire section along nicely. What I'll do is I'll just pop a band just around the nose here. So we just get that around there, just holding the nose in place. Okay, then we just start down here. Just going to drop it behind the wing root, and you can automatically see the capillary action start to work its way along. Then what we're going to do is just going to drop it down that seam line that runs down there. Don't over flood it. You've got to make sure it does go the entire distance, because you don't want to get a gap down there like that. Okay, when you're happy with that one, if you wanted to, you could clamp there and move around to the next side, various bits and pieces. So what we'll do, we're just going to pop a clamp just down there like so, just to hold that into position. Okay, just onto the other side, just run it down. Just a bit around the back there, just like that. There we go, and we just hold that in position. And you should get a very nice join along that bottom edge. So we just hold that for a moment, and that can start to go. And then what I've done with this one here, as you can see, I've already glued this one in place already. If you put rubber bands around the back end, just like this, and then you can spot glue between them all. So if we just pop a rubber band around here. Okay, I'm just going to make a simple three piece along. There we go, whip that off a sec. And then what we can actually do, as I say, we just start up in that wing root area just at the back there. Want to run it along the bottom of that wing joint, because in a minute it'll all pull together. And all we'll do is just going to touch a tiny bit along those top edges, and the capillary action will pull itself all the way along. Quite a bit around this back edge, to be honest. Just along like that, then we can pinch this bottom, hold it. What we'll do, we'll sand that area back up in a moment. We're just going to pinch it just for a minute, just to get it all going. Same on the other side. There's a quite a nice generous bit down that wing root edge, because you do get a tiny little gap just in here. There's a top and half as a meet up down the back there. That's it. We're just going to do, because we're going to sand very lightly along this entire area anyway. So we're just going to, and then like that. And then just inside the back where the two fuselages come together, top and bottom. Okay, again, we'll just pinch the back and just hold it and let that dry just for a couple of minutes. Because with the tam you're extra thin, what you can do is if you put a very, very little amount down, it dries very, very quickly. The more you put down, the heavier it is, the thicker it is, the longer it's going to dry, obviously. So what is a nice little way to do is pop around spotting it on just like that. When you're happy it's all held in position, perhaps after half an hour, pop back, give it another coat right the way through, and that'll take care of any little joins and seams.